welcome to this documentary. I'm being a Kuer Koor of AG Media. I'm traveling to town of Nakuru, where I'll meet Maketh Kuer Koor, one of the South Sudanese Americans working with Centerpiece Global Partners. Centerpiece Global Partners Limited was the initiative of former South Sudanese Lostboys who live in the United States and Australia. Maketh, who owned another apartment in the eastern part of Nakuru, saw another opportunity, and that was when he convened his fellow South Sudanese to invest in the project. The team of 45 members collected little money to buy land in Kenya and build a small village. They were able to purchase land of 12 kilometers in the west of Nakuru town, just northeast of Njoro town, in 2016. When the Centerpiece Global Partners bought this land in 2016, it was empty farmland. Maketh and his team were determined to ensure that the 5 acres of land were turned into a living space. The construction of the current 20 homes and the fence started in 2017. This allows locals to find jobs for the last 4 to 5 years. 20 of the 28 homes were completed and ready to be opened to the public on 18th of December this year. The grand opening is expected to bring the governor of Nakuru County and other dignitaries who are invited to the event. The development of the Centerpiece Village attracted new development to the area. And soon, Nakuru West will be a growing part of the town. As it appears, Centerpiece Village will be gated community with its own shopping center. Each house has 3 bedrooms, 3 bathrooms, a modern kitchen, and a lounge. The parking lot will take 4 cars, and there are trees planted all over the property. Centerpiece Global Partners are yet to tell us the price of these houses that were to be rented out. To help you understand what is going on within the Centerpiece Village, Maketh Kuer Koor here will tell you the story of when and how the project was started. He will help you understand what it took for him and the team to build these houses.
Hello, my name is Gabriel Maketh Kuer. I'm one of the members of Centerpiece Global Partners, a group of investors from diaspora who took an initiative to come and invest back home in Africa. This project that we have has been ongoing for a while. It's almost about going 5 years now, and the idea was that can we go to an open space where we can get adequate space, and we design it to the comfort that we think our customers will appreciate. One of the major problems I've seen in many cities in Africa is the fact that the zoning is just really, really, really not good. So in 2016, we came to Nakuru, Kenya, and we decide to buy a 5 acres land. So this 5 acres land, we divide it into sections. The first section is supposed to house about 28 homes. And then the second section, which is also going to be a business section, and also it will have apartment in it, is this section. So on our first phase, we were able to construct about 20 homes, 5 bedrooms each. And these homes are ready now to be occupied, but we have not started on the other 8. The houses were meant to the standard of the people that can be able to appreciate, so we actually put a lot of work into it. The only thing lacking here is the air condition, and you know, in Kenya, the weather is quite good. You don't need a air conditioner here. Mostly, if you are in the United States, we will say it about 65 to about upper 80s, so you don't need a air conditioner, but everything in it is actually to the standard. We are going to put the sign very soon because it's going to be open on the 18th. It's going to be for Centerpiece Global Village. That will be the name of the community because it's our local village. Let me just come and show you what is in here and the way things have been arranged. First of all, we have a very tight security. If you can see here, you can see actually electrical wire. So after dark, we turn the light on and it become like energized, active. So you cannot be able to jump over. On the top of that, the entire community has been wired with a CCTV. You can see two of them over there and some of them on that house. There is about maximum of about 6-4 cameras surrounding the entire community. When you come here, we have a wall divided the common section from the private section because this is whereby individual homeowners are going to be. At this house is actually a security system where we control security from here. So this is where the watchman is going to be. This fence is going to be blocked from here, and we're going to open another gate over there so that the public can have access to the shopping mall, to the gym, and the other amenities that are going to support this community. Our goal is actually to live off the grid. This place is about 12 kilometers from the city center, Nakuru city center. And we have our own private water system, as you have seen. All the houses have hard water, so you can actually mix as you please. As you can see, all the solars on the top. So it's just like being Sydney or Kansas City, wherever you are. They know an amenity you are missing here. Here we will put maybe a fence if the community decide to. But what we have done is we create a really very nice space. Have you have seen here, you have a place that you can park up to almost about 4 cars, so you can have 2 on this side and 2 on this side. As I mentioned earlier, our goal was to live off the grid, not being attached to the city, but to live off the grid. That means everything that supports the system is in the community. If you see here, you will see the gathering system. That gathering system is wired down and it takes the water down there. We actually don't use that water. It's just to handle the overflow and the water just dry down. We don't use the water over there. Around here is another system. Over here is actually a biodigester. What happened is they come up with a new technology in Kenya whereby they put enzyme down, and so when the waste and the other thing that come from the house come here, the enzyme will turn it into water. So when the enzyme turn it to water, there's another septic tank around this place whereby they have digged about 30 meters deep. So the water will go down there and they will dry up. So that is how you do. And you don't have to deal with the sewage system, which I think is great. So there's a lot of system going on here. It's just like you can't see because everything has been completed and nice. And it's also not quite expensive. The technology is not quite expensive. It's environment friendly. It consumes so many little space. I did try to make a one biodigester, but the reason is if there was malfunction in one house, it will be so difficult to detect where the problem is. But with this, you can be able to isolate, because if one house has a problem, you can know it's that particular house. Then you can go down and fix it. Well, when we started the construction, I was really, really, really very adamant about these flowers. I started planting them when I was starting the foundation. And even the technician, they did not understand why I asked for that. But now they can see, and actually they can appreciate, they add a tremendous amount of value to the property. And one of the problems that, like I said earlier, in Africa is sometimes we feel like we're going to move out tomorrow. This is home. This is where we stay. This is our place. Even if it is small, although it is squeezed, you can make something decent, something that desirable. And the Kenyan technician, actually, I'm amazed by the level of the skill. I mean, if you can see the kind of the stone they have to shape this stone. They are actually machine shape, but they do something called the keying when the house is done. There's a very beautiful place called Olakarao, that's where we get this one. And it shows you the beauty of Africa, to be honest. If you see here, there are a lot of mineral come at different shapes. The nature has been so kind to Africa. You see just this beautiful stone coming at different colors. You just have to take them from the earth, and that is it. And here is the house. It has you cannot compare it to our houses in the West. Even if I can change my office in Kansas City with one of these houses, I'll be happy to take one, because it has a better low maintenance, beautiful stone, going to outlive a lot of generations, because it is a really literally a permanent house. You can see the glasses here is one-way glass. If you are inside, no one will see you, but you will see somebody from inside, but nobody can see from inside. Like now, even if you focus your camera, you will not be able to see exactly what is going in. So sometimes I will have a lot of fun here, because when you go upstairs, there's a lot of birds. They will come and just sit here, and you will just look like the little detail, because they are not seeing you and they are not flying away, because you are on the other side of the glass. This is the veranda. So when the houses were drawn, they were actually done in the Kenyan system. But when I came back from my second tour, I said, no, we can't do this. We are going to have an open kitchen. But this one is more of an American Western building style. And come in, let me show you around. So if you see here, actually, we imported most of these materials. You can see the door, the nature of the door. Not only these doors like this, but all the doors in the house are of this caliber. You can see it's almost about 12 inches, really big. It's really big. It's about 10 by 4, I guess, or it's been more. So these are what give the value to the house. Like I mentioned earlier, you can see every detail outside, but somebody can stand literally at the window and they will not be able to see what's going on here. This can accommodate up to almost 8 chairs. You can have a dining table of 8 chairs. Actually, we're going to put it before the opening. This is where you wash your hand, actually. Hot water mixing with the cold water, they mix here, so you have to see where you want to adjust. If you want to go hot, you go that. If you want to go cold, you go this way. So this is the kitchen. It's an open kitchen. So sometimes you can even have like a stool by here during breakfast, and then you eat your breakfast here while other family members are eating on this side. This is the counter, and this is the light system. This is our tap. You can see the sink, and you know, you can see the caliber of the sink that we have, and the faucet. It's really big. If you come here, there is a hood. So if you are cooking, especially Sudanese that will do a lot of cooking with food with smoke, this take the smoke out of the house. So it will take the smoke out, and that go and exit at the outside. You can put your fridge over here. Can put actually a double door fridge can fit here. And then the cooker can be able to go right here. So if you want to get connected, you get connected here. That is the cooker. And we have enough cabinet as we have seen here. This cabinet, you can put a lot, you can store a lot of stuff. not to mention all the cabinet around here. So this is where you wash your hands. That is the toilet seat, which is really very big, as you see. This is the shower. You have two shower heads. You have this. If you don't want to stand on the shower, you can salvage yourself with this. And then put it back if that's what you want. Target cleaning, I guess. We put a provision here. So in case if there's any problem with the hot water solar system, so that you can put a shower head, the one that they use here in Kenya, you can put it here, so that the instant shower heater. But it's not really, I don't think they're going to use it because there's sun throughout. And the beauty with this solar system, even if it is just cloudy and there's light out, it's still going to be hot, really, really hot. I'll show you later when we turn on one of the waters. This is the cabinet light, as you've seen it. It's quite an investment in the term of the material. So when I start this project, I want to build a house that like I was going to live here. And actually, I might live here because my wife usually tells me, we're going to get one house out of this because they like it. You can see another lighting system here. That is the same thing over here. Very good lighting system out of this place. On the clear day, actually, you can have like a lake view here. You can see the lake on the top of the tree. But today is a little bit foggy coming here. Okay, this is a study room, so you can be able to put your classes in you can be able to put your shelf, your study, your computer. If you want to work from home, you can work from home from here. And this is actually a balcony that you can come out and have some fresh air and see the nature. Coming here is the second bathroom. We did it like the American system, whereby you have the shower and the toilet seat in the same, and then here's your wash basin. You have it here, and over here, this is another bedroom. This can be for kids. Put one there and put the other one there for two kids. That would be enough for them, especially when they are young. Especially for the young families, they like to be with their babies most of the time. Coming here, this is the master bedroom. This is actually the dressing table for the mother of the house, so they have to see themselves here, put all the belongings, you know, wig, whatever it is, put it over there, lotions. There's enough storage. This is the wardrobe. So have a plenty of space, as you see. You can store anything in this place, as you see. So master bedroom is big enough. You can see it's going to be one bed. You can put one bed this way, or you can put it this way, whatever way you're going to put it. It's a big space for one bed, to be honest. The whole of this place. So no matter how big the bed is, you can almost put even two double beds if you want to. Over here in the bathroom, it's because it's bath and suit. This is a hand washing thing over here. Again, the shower, the small head that you wash your body, and then the main shower over there. Provision the same as the other. And then when you come here, this is the master bedroom, place of coming out, you know. You can come and see the city. The beauty of this place, especially at night, you can see like the town down. So it just lit up overnight, and it has really a very good view, especially around 8 to 9 p.m. when you come over here. You're going to love it. Here is the life-saving system I was telling you that I started. when I saw the houses. You see the trees are coming up. Well, what we did is every house we put two trees, and then there's another set of trees we have done. They call them Italian cypress. You can see all of these cypress, each house, they're going to be like that when they mature. So these were just to add beauty. They call them cobblestone in America, but here in America, they just, in Kenya, they call them cobros. So this is how we have taped all the area, so there will be nowhere you will see a dust or a mud when everything is said and done. So this place is going to be clean as much as it can. Thing I talk about the solars earlier, you see each and every house has its own water system. And the beauty of that is if one house have a problem, you can be able to isolate and you fix it.
Okay, what you are looking at here, as I explained early, that the plan is to build 28 homes. 28 homes, you can see the 20 has already been completed, but 8 houses will be built in this space. We are going to leave the space of 2 homes, that is about almost a quarter acre land, to be a playing ground whereby the kids and community members, if you're bored being at home, to go and sit and relax. So like I said earlier, this was meant to be a self-sustained community that you have everything. And especially when the shopping mall is going to be built and finished, you don't have to go to town to go and get anything. You can get everything here. Actually, not far away from here, we're going to go there just to go and have soda later. That place, they have a school inside, primary school and secondary school. It's owned by the church, but it's a resort. It's not far away from here, about 3 minutes. So that one will be the one of the school our children will be going to from this community. We have some more school this way. There's an Australian guy who have a school, and he actually shut that school down because of funding. Actually, it was convenient us if we can acquire the school. It's just like now, our hands are full and we can't do it. That school will be full, so useful for us. So that means leaving Nakuru town and come here, meaning that you are in a place that you get everything without any challenges, because we're going to have everything in this community that will support your life and the life of your family. At the end of the day, what we need is the comfort. We need a place that you can feel like a home without a noise. So as soon as the funds come our way, we will start working on this, we will implement this, and then we'll put our park over there. One of my brother-in-law, one of my partner brother-in-law, he work here as a security person. So he decided to put a maze over here. I was telling him even before the opening that I want to clear this place, and he say, "Yeah, you gotta pay me first." So what they're going to do actually, they're going to plant the trees. They're gonna plant the trees that it actually cut the fence and turn the stone to a live fence. Have you seen here? They cover the whole thing, but it has been done better on the other side comparing here. If you can come and see inside here, you can see in the network. So there's just a lot of beautiful plants here in Kenya that you can almost do anything. So the goal is to be able to put all the fence to be covered by the live fence, so that can give you the beauty that you want instead of plastering. And actually it's cheaper that way. All these blocks here, the water channel, we do them here on the side. We do them just on the next side of the property. Yeah, these are street lights. They are actually powered by
solar.
So we don't really use anything.
So people will be wondered what it took to build something like this. This was just a collection of little guys who realize that pulling the resources together and work together can actually make difference. So when we started the project, we started recruiting some of our colleagues in the diaspora, particularly United States and Australia. We actually reached out also to Canada, but we didn't get anybody to recruit from Canada. So when we pulled those resources together, we structured the way we were going to come up with the fund. And annually, we have a certain target whereby each member has to pay into the system. And we agree it's going to be for 4.5 years. So little by little, we collect that money, and here we are with what we have built. So this is a testimony of the power of the numbers and build a system that works and a trust. Today, somebody, bureaucrat, one of my members, sent me a text from Kampala. I didn't know even he was in Africa, that he was going to come to Nakuru for the opening on the 18th. There are some people I never met in real life, and I don't know them. If I meet them on the road and nobody introduced me to them, there's no way I'm going to know them because I don't know them in person. But they have that trust whereby they put the resources in the hand of our organization so that we can be able to deliver what we have delivered. Now, yes, the work is not quite done, but I can't wait for the work to be done so that I can just go home, sit back with my children, and show the guys, here is what we have done for this particular project. The goal, why we did this, there's a lot of questions from the diaspora community that, is it even safe to invest in Africa? The answer is, it depends where. But here in Kenya, what I can tell you for sure is, it's actually safe to build here in Kenya. Part of the mission of Centerpiece Global Partners, the organization that we are running, is to be able to create a bridge whereby people who want to do something on this side of the world, that they can have a partner that can be able actually to help them to achieve that goal. Because our mission is not really to get rich. Our mission is to make different. If you see the amount of the investment we have done here, if I would have said we would have not started, we would not have even a single penny of the money we have invested here, because otherwise we would have used them. Another thing I've learned from the process is, we in the diaspora sometimes we say we don't have fun. Yes, we don't, but we do. We do. And the reason why I say we do is, if you have not find something that you're going to put money on, I mean something that valuable you're going to put money on, you're not going to realize you have that money. So when it comes to equity like the one we have built, it is stored that money, and you can be able to physically see, you can still be able to use the money while they are still there. So like your money is actually making you money. And the property don't depreciate, it appreciates every year. So that is the beauty of it. The reason why I want to empathize on that, especially we, the generation that were born in South Sudan, we were born in quite different economical system, not the one we have. The Western economic system that we are in today, it came as an accident. It's something that we did not plan for, but that should not hold us back from catching up with the world, because we have the opportunity. So what is lacking sometimes is the system, and building the system, that is what we are trying to do. So you cannot build a viable society whereby your citizen or your members, they live in other people's houses, they eat food produced by other people, their children go to school that built by other people, they go to hospital built by the other people. You are not sustainable society if you have those combinations. So what we are trying to do, or what we are trying to show, is that we can build a viable, economical viable society. That is in our reach, and here is the proof that we did it. So if 45 members did this, what about if we were 450 people? How much would we have done? I'm just going to give you a small example of our communities in Jonglei. I came from one of the Payam in two years called Kongor. 400 people, I think in the United States alone, we are almost to that number. In our Payam only. I'm not talking even the entire Three East County. Now imagine three counties of Jonglei, the other part of South Sudan. When we did this, we opened it up. It is not the three communities that came from Jonglei that put things together. We have people as far as Northern Barkazal. We have people from Ruweng administrative area. They are with us, and we are doing this together. And we would have a person from even Central Equatorial State if they would have trust us and join us. But we have to show first. So we kind of go with the people that will accept us. But it was quite open. Here is why this matters. We have a large generation coming up in the West. That generation is at risk to be assimilated to those societies, and that will be end of it. I don't think they're going to come back. But if you build a wealth here, that wealth will attract them here, because if you die, you don't die with the wealth, so the children have to come and money the wealth. So that will connect the root to them. Another also important thing is changing of the landscape. When we came to this place, it was just an open field. But you can see now, it's quite different. If you see the number of people we employ here, different small companies, like the people who put the windows are different from people who make those metal at the top. The people who put doors are different from the people that will make the grass. The people who install the water tank are different from the people that will put the electrical work. People who put the painting are different from the people who make cobros. So you see these so little companies that came and benefit because of work they are doing. For people who follow me on the Facebook, I think you remember a few years ago, I make a lot of proposal about the idea of actually coming to invest in Africa. And one of the things that stressed me out so bad was at the time where there was a migration crisis going on between West Africa and Europe. And a lot of young people were actually drowning in the sea. It breaks your heart whereby you see a boat carrying almost 1,000 people go down and nobody come back. And though for those who make it to the boundaries of Italy or the other European country, you will be treated worse than an animal. Not to mention the cartel that were doing this in Libya were literally locking up people. It was purely a slavery. So, we are the members of this society. We have a moral obligation. It's not everything that has to be provided to us by the people outside. There are things that we can do for ourselves. It comes down just to a better management of resources. And that is whereby we in the Centerpiece Global Partners, that is what motivates us. This was just a trial, but we are not stopping here. We will do more. And by the grace of God, we can go to another places like South Sudan if they will, if they are willing to work with us, and if they want us to come and help, we are more than happy. What puts people away from places like South Sudan sometimes is lack of the system, especially when it comes to the issues of the land. But here is the question I'm going to ask yourself. Now, if I go to maybe a Central Equatoria or a place that is not my native home in South Sudan, I will be told that I'm grabbing land when I'm actually trying to make different. Look this way. The globalization has opened the doors. If a guy in Torit is going to control his land not to be devolved, a guy in Nakuru will be able to allow his land to be used, and that will be the benefit of that society. So if you go to Torit today, these houses are not standing in Torit today, but they are standing here in Nakuru because there's a system that works comparing to torit. So I'm not picking on torit, I'm just saying a small example of how small things make difference. And there are a lot, actually, not only Kenya, there's a lot of countries in Africa that you can actually go and invest without any problem. So we have a choice. We have a choice, and our time is not waiting. We have to do what we can with our time, and that's why you see we make such a sacrifice like the one we are doing right here. Hello, my name is Gabriel Maketh Kuer. Welcome to Centerpiece Village. This is the property that we are going to open on the 18th of December 2021 with the Governor of Nakuru, Honorable Lee Kenyaju, to be the master of the ceremony. We are appealing to you to join us. It will be a little bit difficult to reach everybody, but this is the shortest means. I know sometimes as Sudanese we want to be individually invited, or as South Sudanese we want to be individually invited. With the technology, we are calling you instead of sending out all those cards. You save the date and come and see what we have done and the thing we want to do. It is our pleasure to come and see, and maybe this might be the community that you want to live in when you come and see what we have. So on the 18th, mark your day down, the program is going to start running. We are working on the program. We are about 10 miles from, or 10 kilometers from the city center, and we have organized how we are going to bring people to the site. So that is on us, you have nothing to worry. All you need is to be able to go to the assembling point where we will be taking people to come here. There will be a quite of entertainment as some of the communities has reached out when we invited them that they want to show their culture. So you need to be here, and it's my pleasure to invite you on the behalf of our team to come to our celebration of our work, opening of Centerpiece Global Partners Village that is going to be initiated on the 18th of December 2021.